Simon & Schuster Audio presents an Inner Traditions audiobook, Psychedelic Buddhism, A User's Guide to Traditions, Symbols, and Ceremonies by Lama Mike Crowley. Read by Michael Ellick. Preface. What is a psychedelic? An email to my 7-year-old granddaughter. 5 years ago, I received an email from my granddaughter. I was delighted at the communication, as it was my first email from her. It was brief and to the point. It said, "Dear Grandpa, could you please tell me about the drugs that make you see things? Love, E." I mean, what? As my granddaughter was only 7 years old at the time, I was more than a little puzzled by this request. A phone call to her mother soon explained it, though. E had asked her parents if ghosts were real, and they had replied, "Maybe, but there are lots of reasons why people might see things that aren't there or misinterpret things that are." They then listed several reasons, including grief, sickness, insanity, and finally, drugs. "But," they said, "you should ask your granddad about that last one. He knows much more about that than we do." Armed with that clarification, I responded thus. "Dear E, if you see something that is not really there, it's called a hallucination. There are several drugs that will give you hallucinations, and many of these are plants. A few of these plants, like deadly nightshade, grow in England. You may have already seen nightshade growing in hedgerows on your country walks. It's quite a pretty plant with small white flowers and shiny fruit that look like black currants. The word fruit here is just a scientific term and does not mean that they're edible. In fact, the word deadly in the plant's name should tell you that it's best to just admire their appearance, not their taste. For some reason, most of these hallucination-causing plants are also poisonous, though that doesn't seem to stop some people eating them on purpose. I have met a few of these people, and they report not only seeing people and animals that weren't really there, but also having conversations with them, even with the animals. These drugs are quite different from those called psychedelic, which can make you misinterpret something that really is there. For instance, someone under the influence of psychedelic drugs could see a coiled housepipe and think it's a snake. Just briefly, though, for maybe a second or two, before seeing it as something else, like a baby dragon or a miniature castle. Mostly, though, they merely make you see things with your eyes closed, like complicated color patterns and fantastic landscapes. For this reason, these psychedelic drugs were once called hallucinogens, hallucination causers, but scientists stopped using this name because these drugs didn't really make you see things that weren't actually there. Another name that's no longer used for them is psychotomimetic, which means imitating madness. But this was found to be not very accurate either. Psychedelic is a more modern name meaning showing the contents of the mind. Another name is entheogenic, meaning creating the God within. I prefer psychedelic, though, because everyone has their own ideas of what the word God might mean and whether such a being could be created. Unlike the nightshade type of drugs, the psychedelic drugs are usually not at all poisonous, nor are they usually habit-forming. They are sometimes used medically, especially as they can make someone remember things that they'd long forgotten. People who have had very sad experiences often try to forget them and bury them deep in their mind. When they do this, although they can't remember them easily, these buried memories can still cause them problems. That's where the psychedelics are useful. When used with a specially trained doctor, patients may be coaxed to recall these sad experiences and talk about them with the doctor. There are hundreds of psychedelic drugs, many of them invented by granddad's friend, Dr. Shulgin. The best known psychedelic is called LSD, which is not one of Dr. Shulgin's, And another well-known one is a small mushroom that grows on grasslands all over England, and especially Wales. I hope this helps. If you have any questions, please email me again. Love, Granddad. This seemed to answer my granddaughter's brief question, as she didn't email me back. I'm told that there was one direct consequence, however. When my son-in-law was mowing their lawn a few weeks later, she exclaimed, "Wait, Daddy, stop! There's a mushroom! Don't mow it! It might be one of the special ones that Granddad told me about." Despite this shroom not being in any way psychoactive, I'm told that he obediently mowed around it. This book is not about that first category, the drugs that make you see things that really aren't there. It's about the others, the psychedelics. Merging Psychedelics and Buddhism. A note about this book. I personally remember an occasion when, in the mid-1980s, a young lady named Vanessa and I tried our first ever dose of MDMA in the area above Clifton Gorge near Bristol, England. We began in a botanical garden, but when the effects hit us, we headed for the solitude of the nearby woods and fields. After a few hours spent marveling at the miraculous manifestations of nature, Vanessa began expressing the view of reality that the experience provided. Despite having zero acquaintance with Buddhist philosophy, she began propounding the Mahayana view of total voidness. She even used the word unborn to describe the underlying no-thingness of reality. I was agog, not just because of her sudden burst of ancient wisdom, but because unborn is the literal translation of the Sanskrit word abhava, a technical term used in Mahayana scriptures for that very thing, or the same no thing, if you see what I mean. Then there was my own experience of Indra's net. I had taken a teaspoon of cannabis tincture, and simply to counteract any possible somnolence, shared a tablet of orange sunshine, a variety of LSD, with two friends. Based on my previous experiences with the tincture, I expected the evening to be one of rapturous appreciation of music while slumped in an armchair. The LSD was mostly to keep me from nodding off to sleep if I got a bit too cozy. Admittedly, I welcomed the possibility that the psychedelic might add a splash of color, but I didn't hold out too much hope for spiritual revelation. It was, after all, only a third of a tablet. I certainly didn't expect the profound and inspiring vision that ensued. Footnote. As fate would have it, much later in life I became friends with Nick Sand, one of the two alchemists responsible for creating Orange Sunshine. In 2005, we chatted about this batch of tablets, and I asked if it was really LAD, an analog of LSD, as had been claimed in court. "Oh no," he said. "They were just stronger." He then went on to tell me how each tab had around 350 micrograms, or mics, of LSD. Thus, the third of a tab, which I considered a mere additive to a cannabis high, was approximately 117 mics, a reasonably solid dose by today's standards. As repeated trials using identical dosages have failed to achieve anything remotely like this, it seems to meet Sasha Shulgin's criteria for a plus four, aka plus 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 experience, a random, dose-independent mystical effect. It was 1970, and I was among a group of young people gathered at a house in the English countryside. The French windows opened onto the patio, and the scents of a warm summer evening wafted in from the garden. Friends chatted amicably, two pet rabbits hopped, apparently at random, through the deep shag carpet, and J.S. Bach's The Art of Fugue emanated in geometrical precision from our host's geeked-out hi-fi. This sublime music seemed perfect for my elevated state, so I closed my eyes and let the music transport me. Then, appearing before my inner eye, like imagination, only far more vivid, I beheld an infinite array of crystalline spheres, suspended in space within its own three dimensions. Each was so perfectly spherical and so perfectly clear that it contained within it the perfect reflection of every other sphere.
We hope you enjoyed this preview. To continue listening to this audiobook on Google Play Books, use the link in the video description.